Okay, dear Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, I will present you a difficult case of extraction. Next slide. As you can see, it's a woman born in 1939. She presented a congenital AV block. She was implanted in 1979. 40 years ago, at the date of extraction, with an epicardial VVI pacemaker in a submammary position. And in 1981, she had a first infection, and she had an extraction of the epicardial pacemaker. And in 1981, next slide, she was re-implanted via a cephalic vein with a VVI air pacemaker. So 1981, as you can see, it's really a very old implantation. She was implanted 29 years before extraction. You remember, it's just a wink, in 1981, some events, it's really the past. In 2000, due to a problem of a very high threshold, she was re-implanted with a new ventricular lead by an internal jugular vein because failure of re-implantation by right side due to a thrombosis. She is in permanent AF. She's PM-dependent, totally PM-dependent, without any escape rhythm. Next slide. As you can see, she presented with a device erosion with probably a pocket abscess with some skin adherences. Next slide. You can see the chest X-ray with two very old leads. The first lead, next slide. The first lead was implanted in 1981 by a cephalic vein. And the second lead is implanted by the internal jugular vein in 2000. So two leads in place. Next slide. So what to do as a, what you propose as clinical management? A, complete, it's a question, complete percutaneous extraction with laser, upper approach, complete rotating mechanical sheath, because some people think that is safer. C, complete percutaneous extraction, hybrid approach, upper and femoral. C, surgical extraction, because very old lead, two old leads. D, pocket revision and only submuscular reimplantation, because two old leads. Or E, lead abandonment and contralateral reimplantation, because two old leads. In fact, we choose A, B, or perhaps C, complete extraction, first with laser. It can be with tight rail. And if it was difficult, we can also use an upper or a femoral approach. Next slide, please. We decide to perform a complete extraction, despite very old lead from 1981. As you can see, we perform a phlebography CT scan before extraction, and we can see that there was probably a thrombosis of the left axis and also a thrombosis of the right axis. Next slide. Here you have the operating file from 2000 when the patient was re-implanted and the surgeon at this time failed to re-implant the lead from the right axis due to thrombosis, a complete thrombosis of the innominate vein. Next slide. So back to our case, you remember that one lead is implanted in the cephalic vein, one by the jugular vein. We prepare The case was performed as usually in my center in the operating theater. The CP bypass is ready in the operating theater. Atrial and venous femoral line treatment. And we had no bridge balloon at this time. It was 4 or 5 years ago. The patient was intubated and for ventilation, TE in place, and we had an arterial line also. Next slide. In fact, if the extraction occurred in 2020, we use a bridge occlusion balloon with a guide wire in place through the superior vena cava. But at this time, we didn't have bridge occlusion balloon. You can see some an example of a very recent extraction with a guide wire in place before extraction. Next slide. So back to our case. You remember what one lead is implanted by cephalic vein, one by jugular vein. So we need to perform two incisions, one incision for extraction of the lead from 1981 and one incision for the lead implanted through the jugular vein. Next slide. One temporary lead is implanted by left femoral approach because we need that the right femoral approach has to be free now for the bridge balloon, but at this time also in case if we need to extract by femoral approach. So first we implant a temporary lead. Next slide. We begin by the more recent lead, the lead implanted by jugular approach. So we use by jugular approach glide light, a 14 French glide light, so laser sheet. And the glide light move forward to the tip of the lead. You can see the progression of the glide light. Next slide. Here you can see that we move forward to the superior vena cava. In the superior vena cava, we try to don't use laser, to use only mechanical approach with the laser. And there was a lot of adherences to the superior vena cava, so we move very slowly and we go to the tip of the lead. Next slide. And then we extract, next slide, the entire lead from the jugular approach. The second time of extraction, we extract the lead from 1981 with a glide light. We use a glide light to this approach and we move forward to the tip of the lead. And next slide, we extract totally all the lead from 2000 and the lead from 81 totally with femoral approach. And then we reimplant, because the patient was totally dependent, temporarily lead with a screw-in lead by a jugular approach, another jugular approach, and we close both incisions. And we use a Medtronic lead, a screw-in Medtronic lead, with an old pacemaker. Next slide. So second question, how to reimplant? A, right side reimplantation. B, homolateral reimplantation 3 weeks later. C, epicardial implantation. Or D, next slide, D, leadless PM reimplantation. As you know, in 2020, we reimplant now leadless pacemaker in case of infection, particularly in this case because the patient was in atrial fibrillation, and it's a for me, a good case of reimplantation with leadless. Next slide. In fact, at this time, we reimplant. We try first to reimplant by right approach, but as we can imagine, it was impossible due to a thrombosis. So we move to the femoral and we reimplant leadless. It was 4 years ago, and at this time we used to implant a nanostim from St. Jude Abbott. So we reimplant, you can see it's a screw-in nanostim lead. We perform a right ventricular angiography before, and we implant, next slide. We reimplant a nanostim pacemaker. You can see, next slide. I think so. It's a movie because no venous access and infection. And you can see the implantation of the nanostim pacemaker. And the final position of the nanostim leadless pacemaker. So this nanostim is implanted, I think, on the low septum. But you can see that the proximal tip of the nanostim is relatively high and not easy to grab in case of extraction because very, very high. But it's another story. Next slide. But the story never ends because two major issues happen concerning nanostim. The first issue is it's an alert concerning battery failure. And you can see that we had a very high rate of battery failure, around 17% of battery failure at an average time of 3.6 years. And you can see the curve of battery failure reported worldwide after the battery advisory time is very, 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 very high. Next slide. And the battery failure happened very acutely with no symptoms before. And you know that the battery failure was due to an increase in impedance, internal impedance with dryness. Very, very acutely. Next slide. And another issue, another problem happened with nanostim, problem due to three cases of docking button detachment, and due to the this docking button detachment, based on these two issues, St. Jude Abbott decide to redesign a new leadless pacemaker and to stop the development of this pacemaker. So based on these two issues, the solution was to re-implant, next slide, a new pacemaker. You can see the case of the 199 case of retrieval attempts of nanostim's retrieval in March 2020. Next slide. So we decide, due to the totally dependency of the patient and the high risk of battery failure, to re-implant a new leadless pacemaker. To try to retrieve the nanostim and to re-implant a new leadless. If we decide to re-implant a new leadless, we are obliged to re-implant a micro pacemaker from Medtronic. So first, we perform an angiography, a right ventricular angiography, to look if there is some sign of adherences of the nanostim. You can see that the nanostim is very high and the proximal tip is very high after the tricuspid valve. We decide, in fact, to implant first the micra because the patient was a PM dependent and it was easier for the patient and for the procedure. Next slide. And we try to, you can see the position in LAO of the two leadless, so first the micra here And the nanostim is longer but thinner than the micro. Next slide. And next slide. And we try with a very dedicated sheet to retrieve the nanostim, but next slide. Yes, but in fact, it was a failure. I'm not the perfect image, but we try to grab the docking button, but it was in fact impossible and very risky due to the micro beside. So we decide to abandon the nanostim. And in fact, it was the only case of failure with attempt of retrieve nanostim in my center. Next slide. You can see some case of extraction of nanostim. Generally, there is no adherences. Here you have a case of with a lot of adherences, but it was possible to retrieve because the docking button had no adherences. Next slide. One case, I have not the case of extraction of last week, but we have no adherences in a case last week. So I think we can conclude. And concerning takeoff message of this extraction, we can say that it's feasible to extract percutaneously very, very old leads. We can use laser sheet or mechanical sheet, but it's a intervention, it's high risk, very risky intervention. And of course, we need in 2020 to use guy wire and bridge balloon, cardiac surgeon inside the operating room, CP bypass 3D. And concerning reimplantation, we have more and more reimplantation with leadless pacemaker, but we may have some PM recall even with new devices and with leadless at nanostim. And we can retrieve leadless, or we have also the possibility to add a new leadless and a micro besides the nanostim. Thank you very much.